Good afternoon, colleagues. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio this afternoon is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. A reminder that members wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Rachel Hamilton. Hamilton does not appear to be in the chamber, which is more than regrettable. We need to move on to question two, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting culture in the North East Scotland region.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Presiding Officer, since the last External Affairs questions, the United Nations has concluded its review of the UN Relief and Works Agency for Palestinians report, which has delivered aid in Gaza for the Scottish Government. Germany is now resuming aid through UNRWA, joining the European Union and many others, and would wish to put on record that we would call on the United Kingdom Government to follow the lead of Germany and help the people of Gaza. In answer to Maurice Golden's question, our culture strategy sets out our ambition for culture to thrive across Scotland. We've supported a range of initiatives in the northeast of Scotland, including the North East Culture Collective. For example, one of the projects in the programme has supported creative practitioners to work with young people who are experiencing homelessness to co-design a safe space to enable them to feel connected to their community. Additionally, through funding to Creative Scotland, we support organisations such as Hospital Field in Angus, Creative Dundee, the Deveron Projects and Scottish Sculpture Workshop in Aberdeenshire, to name but a few.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Eden project in Dundee is a potentially transformational one for the city and will be funded by a mixture of private and public sources. However, it is not projected to open until the end of the decade due to a series of complicated actions required. So, what actions will the Scottish Government take to support and maximise the value of the project?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, may I begin by commending Maurice Golden for his long-standing advocacy and for Dundee on the flexibility and innovation that it's shown throughout the transformation of the city. This is affirmed in the designation of Dundee as the first and only UNESCO City of Design in the United Kingdom, and the Scottish Government has invested £38 million in the construction of the world-class V&A Museum of Design as a focal point for the regeneration of the waterfront in the city. We continue our support through annual funding, which helps Dundee to develop a sense of place and a culture of innovation, and I have no doubt that this innovative approach will continue as Dundee looks to maximise the opportunities which arise as the Eden project develops in the city.
And supplementary, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The launch of Scotland's International Culture Strategy is very welcome and it is important. I myself was able to meet with the French ambassador recently in Aberdeen. Can the Cabinet Secretary say any more about the steps which the Scottish Government is taking to promote and develop Scotland's international cultural connections and the opportunities that this can create for the sector, including in the northeast of Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, firstly, a huge word of thanks to organisations across the northeast of Scotland for contributing to the public consultation for the International Culture Strategy. Contributions from organisations such as the Scottish Sculpture Workshop, Deveron Projects and Peacock Visual Arts were vital to the strategy's development. The International Culture Strategy sets out a vision for the Scottish culture and creative sector to be globally connected with the means and opportunities to achieve its international ambitions and potential. The Scottish Government's existing international infrastructure will be a key element in delivering on the aims of this strategy and will work with our international offices and other networks across Scotland, including those in the North East, to build on their existing cultural activity to understand where opportunities exist and how to enhance them for the culture and the creative sector.
Question three, Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government how data from the most recent Scottish census is being used.
Cabinet Secretary.
The first results from the 2022 census were published by the National Records of Scotland on Thursday, the 14th of September 2023. These first outputs included estimates of the total population of Scotland and the population size in every local authority area, including a breakdown by five-year age groups and by sex. They also showed the change in population since the last census in 2011. The availability of up-to-date census population data has already facilitated the development of Scottish Government policies, for example, in developing more targeted interventions aimed at supporting communities experiencing population decline, and these results were only the first step in publishing a wide range of unique data from the census. From May 2024, the National Records of Scotland will publish a series of topic data from the 2022 census.
Jimmy Hawker-Johnson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Highlands and Islands already faces many challenges, including the delivery of public services like healthcare, housing and vital lifeline links. Failure to deliver these properly risks the very sustainability of some of our communities. And as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, depopulation is a constant threat. The Scottish Government's Depopulation Action Plan was published in February of this year, but that is before some key data from the Scottish Census has been released. We know the census was delayed, we know it was millions of pounds over budget. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what analysis the Scottish Government has undertaken or is planning to undertake on the impact of the delayed release of census data on their policy development and delivery, and on the ability of other organisations like local councils to deliver on their work?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in answer to Jamie Halkrow-Johnson's questions, firstly, he's absolutely right to draw attention to the importance of census data in being able to deliver public services right across Scotland, including the north of Scotland, including the Northern Isles that I know are very close to his heart. There has been a change in the latest census in the inclusion of what is known as administrative data, which allows for greater granularity using huge data sets which are held throughout Scotland's public services. I know this will be of great interest to him and other colleagues, and I've asked the National Records of Scotland that when the next tranche of information is released, that there should be a meeting for MSPs right across the chamber so that they can understand how that works, raise any needs, interests, concerns and expectations that they may have, so everybody can have confidence the census data is as useful as he knows it to be, and what lessons need to be learned about the conduct of future census and the use of administrative data.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Depopulation, reversal and growth in the islands of Burra and Trondra correlate with the addition of bridges connecting them to the Shetland mainland. The next phase of transport infrastructure in the islands could be short subsea tunnels, helping to boost Scotland's aquaculture and space economy. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that census data should be used to help map depopulation and inform policy in areas such as transport connectivity?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as Beatrice Wishart knows, there's no quick fix for the challenges leading to depopulation. However, the Addressing the Depopulation Action Plan sets out how we will work with regional, with local, with community partners to ensure that we collectively deliver a sustainable solution to these challenges. And I think she's absolutely right to point to the role that the census and census data can play in understanding, yes, differences in population, but other important information that can steer local decision-making, national decision-making, and for the possibility that this may be updated not just every 10 years but in between as well. And in the same way as I said to Jamie Halkrow-Johnson, I would extend to her the opportunity to be able to speak to those who have compiled and worked on the last census to better understand what can we learn from that, but also the ways in which it is now compiled and going into the future. I'm sure it will be of significant benefit to her constituents in Shetland.
And question four, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to support festivals in Dumfries and Galloway.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Creative Scotland provides support for a number of festivals in Dumfries and Galloway, such as the Dumfries and Galloway Arts Festival and Wigton Book Festival. In 2023-24, Creative Scotland provided £107,000 to Dumfries and Galloway Arts Festival through their open fund. Creative Scotland supports Wigton Festival Company, which delivers the Wigton Book Festival, and the Children's Book Festival Big Dog with £86,000 a year. They also support the Stove with £100,000 per year, who run various festivals and events as part of their programme, including events like Nithraid. And between April 2021 and March 2024, Creative Scotland has invested over £3 million in individuals and organisations with a Dumfries and Galloway postcode through their open and their targeted funds.
Colin Smith.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but in recent years in particular, in Dumfries and Galloway, we've lost a number of major music festivals, the Wicker Man Festival, Electric Fields, and most recently Dunheim Festival and the Big Burn Supper, and others like the Eden Festival have had to scale back. Yet when new events come forward, like music at the Multiverse, they don't seem to receive support, and that support for music festivals doesn't seem to be there. So can I ask that the Cabinet Secretary, at a time that Creative Scotland's funding has obviously been reduced by 10%, what specific action can the government take to stop a further erosion of music festivals in Dumfries and Galloway, where those margins are incredibly tight given the rural nature of the region?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Colin Smith knows that I'm very committed to supporting festivals right across Scotland, and it is one of the jewels of our creative sector that we have such fantastic festivals, and I've already outlined the significant support that has been extended to festivals in Dumfries and Galloway. He raises some concerns which I am sure Creative Scotland will have heard. I think he is well aware that Creative Scotland is an arm's length organisation beyond governmental decisions on supporting one festival or one project. That is for Creative Scotland to determine, and I'll make sure that when I meet them next, I will draw their attention to the questions that he specifically raised about Dumfries and Galloway in relation to festivals there.
Question 5, Willie Govey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its policy is on public service broadcasting in an independent Scotland.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
In continuing to deliver on our commitment to give people the information they need to make an informed choice about their future, we set out our policy for broadcasting in the Culture and Independent Scotland paper published in February. With independence, we would build on the strengths of the current broadcasting model, including through the creation of a new Scottish public service broadcaster to better reflect and prioritise the specific needs and interests of Scottish audiences and our creative economy. Ongoing engagement and consultation with the sector and the public would be part of that process.
Willie Coffey.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? I'm sure he will agree that Scotland is not served well on the international stage within the current broadcasting model. Unlike many other national broadcasters, some no bigger than Scotland, we neither see nor hear our voice represented in the world stage from a Scottish perspective. And in my view, the Scottish people are losing out significantly. Can the Minister share some thinking on how this will change for the better when Scotland becomes independent?
Minister.
Well, I think it is important to recognise there is still much good that comes from broadcasting based here in Scotland. We should recognise that. But yeah, I do agree that one of the significant opportunities we would have with an independent public service broadcaster, of course, making sure it was editorially independent of government, of course, making sure that it adhered to the highest standards of impartiality. There would be the opportunity to make sure that we were seeing the world better reflected through a Scottish lens. Of course, any charter for an independent Scottish broadcaster could help ensure that, and as I've set out, there's a commitment to consultation with the sector, with the public, to make sure that we can reach that ambition for an independent Scottish public service broadcaster.
Question 6, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So ask the Scottish Government how Scotland's international cultural strategy will support the aspirations of touring artists.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recognises that the ability to tour and work internationally is vital to many creative professionals, and is deeply regrettable that the UK Government's decision to leave the European Union has made these activities significantly more difficult. A key area of action of our international culture strategy will be to mitigate these impacts, and as part of the strategy, we will work to push the UK Government and the EU to support visa-free arrangements for touring artists and work with the sector to explore new ways to support international mobility. Touring is also a key element of cultural export and exchange activity in the sector. Therefore, we will also undertake a feasibility study into the development of a support service for cultural export and exchange that would help to support international touring and other international activity.
Claire Adamson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. Last week, I attended a sobering roundtable discussion with Face the Music campaign in Scotland, organised by the European Movement. So the touring artists have a stark, it's a stark result of Brexit that they face in terms of visa barriers, as the the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, but also the additional paperwork around carnets and cabotage and a host of bureaucracy that means it is now prohibitively expensive for many, both in time and resource. In my work in the international part, with the PPA, I know that these discussions have been had, but it's very much focused on youth movement in Europe. Can I have the Cabinet Secretary's advice as to what his conversations he's had about the wider cultural activities of Scotland and the wider
cultural opportunities? Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's the view of the Scottish Government that creative professionals should be added to the list of visa-exempt business travellers already contained with the UK-EU Trade and Cooperation Agreement. This could be easily done through the review clauses of the TCA. Scottish Government ministers and officials have regular discussions with UK Government counterparts to make the case for an agreement to minimise all of these barriers and for this to be raised with the EU Commission. As set out in our international culture strategy, we will continue to push the UK Government to negotiate such an agreement and also, incidentally, to rejoin Creative Europe. Of course, the Scottish Government wishes to see an independent Scotland rejoin the European Union, allowing touring artists to benefit once again from freedom of movement, and our recent paper, Culture in an Independent Scotland, sets out our priorities for this to come about.
Supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. These touring artists are being priced out of attendance due to the escalating accommodation costs, and the Chief Executive of the Edinburgh Festival Fringe Society described the current level of Scottish Government support for what is the largest arts festival in the world a national embarrassment and becoming almost impossible to deliver. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government is doing to support that event and also to support these touring artists?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, firstly, I would make the point that discussions between the Scottish Government and important festivals, including the Edinburgh Festival Fringe, are ongoing, and they are constant. It is a jewel in our cultural crown. I say that as Cabinet Secretary for Culture, but yes, also in my capacity as Member of the Scottish Parliament for Edinburgh Central. We need to work through the challenges that there undoubtedly are across the creative and arts sector, and we will do that in partnership with the Edinburgh Festival Fringe and with all others. I would, however, observe that one of the particular challenges that we have with touring artists, it was the second part of his question, is this issue of the difficulty, particularly for younger, less experienced people breaking through in the cultural and arts sector. Last week, we had a proposal from the European Union Commission which would have restored the ability of young people, including artists, to tour without any difficulty right across the European Union. Unfortunately, the first to decline this was the UK Labour government, incidentally a party whose front bench are not even here in culture questions today, and the second to decline it, the UK government. I think that's extremely disappointing.
Thank you. Question 7, Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what the total cost has been of overseas trips undertaken by the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture on behalf of the Scottish Government has been since his appointment in 2021.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Edward Mountain for his questions. Details of all ministerial engagements are proactively published by the Scottish Government as per section 917 in the Ministerial Code. Final cost details from the recent attendance at Tartan Week in the United States are still in the process of being finalised, and I will write to the member with those details as soon as they are available. Tartan Week was a tremendous opportunity to promote Scotland as an excellent place to live, to work, to study, to visit, invest and do business, and I'm particularly grateful to the Tartan Week organisers in the United States, the Scottish Government Office in the United States, Scottish Development International, Visit Scotland and all participants for ensuring it was such a success.
Edward Mountain.
Presiding Officer, I'm not sure that's even an attempted answer to my questions. I'm not sure why the Cabinet Secretary is being so evasive. These trips are funded by the taxpayer and they deserve to hear the answer right here in their own Parliament, exactly what those costs have been. As you all know, the Scottish Government has come in for a lot of criticism for meddling in issues that are reserved to the UK Government. So I would like to know, and give him one more opportunity to answer the question, Presiding Officer, and tell us how much has actually been spent on all his trips since 2021. A figure would be useful.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say it's disappointing that Edward Mountain just read out the supplementary that he prepared before arriving and listening to the answer that I gave him. I did answer the question. I said to Mr. Mountain, if he will give me the opportunity to answer the question yet again, he knows that all international trips are regularly published by the Scottish Government, and as I have made clear, he can huff and puff as much as he likes, presiding officer. It's simply a statement of fact, having only returned in recent weeks from Tartan Week, that the latest travel information has not been finally compiled. As soon as it is, it will be published. I've said it will forward it. It's an entirely reasonable answer to an entirely reasonable question. I'm sure he wouldn't wish me to pluck numbers from the sky and answer them without having the facts which have not yet been completed.
Point of order, Edward Mountain.
Presiding officer, we come to this chamber as members to get answers to questions which we've submitted over a week in advance. How are members expected to come to this chamber and not get answers and to be treated with respect? We're not being treated with respect if we're not given answers, presiding officer. I'd be grateful if you could give a ruling on whether a member has a chance to get an answer and whether the Cabinet Secretary should answer the question that's been put to him.
Mr. Mountain, you will know that the content of both questions and answers are not the responsibility of the Chair. I'm calling question number 8, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the reopening of historic Environment Scotland sites.
Minister Kocab-Stewart.
As we would all expect, Historic Environment Scotland must continue to prioritise the health and safety of visitors, staff and contractors. It continues to work hard to reopen sites as soon as it's safe to do so. And in fact, Historic Environment Scotland has now completed 90% of the priority high-level masonry inspections. And across its estate, there is full or partial access to 90% of its year-round properties. And for further information on any specific site or to learn about the issues from technical experts firsthand, I would be happy to ask the Historic Environment Scotland to arrange a visit for the member. And actually, to put on record, I'd like to thank him for his continued interest in this area as well.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Minister for her response. Before the pandemic, Scotland's historic environment contributed to £4.2 billion to our national economy, with Historic Environment Scotland caring for more than 300 properties of national importance. However, in order to maintain its estate, HES needs to tackle a serious shortage in traditional skills, such as stonemasonry and carpentry. And I know from experience after visiting the rebuild project in Whithorn, just how vital it is to attract and retain fresh young talent to work in Scotland's heritage sector, while crucially creating jobs at the same time. Now, I'm sure the Minister agrees with me that the importance of the new 5-year skills investment plan launched earlier this month, which creates a better skilled workforce right across Scotland. And therefore, can she set out how she envisages HES and how it will work with organisations like Whithorn Rebuild to maintain our historic buildings and create jobs in rural areas?
Minister.
I thank Finlay Carson for that, and I recognise the excellent work that the Whithorn Trust is undertaking with its trainees, and I'm pleased that Historic Environment Scotland is supporting the capacity of the Trust to deliver accredited skills training. As he mentions, a refreshed skills investment plan for Historic Environment was launched recently at the Engine Shed in Stirling, which I was able to attend. That was collaboratively drafted with the sector to reflect the changes that the sector has experienced since its first publication in 2019. Along with Our Past, Our Future, Scotland's historic environment strategy, this will help the traditional skills needed for the sustainability of our heritage assets. And I'd also like to highlight that in his response to Miles Briggs on the 11th of January 2024, the Minister for Higher Education and Further Education and Veterans also recognised the need to ensure that stonemasonry, other traditional skills, including stained glass window, are prioritised within the apprenticeship and training offering.
Thank you. A couple of supplementaries. First, Colin Beattie.
The impact of climate change on our historic environment is clear. Can the Minister provide any update regarding the Scottish Government's latest engagement with HES regarding work that is underway to protect heritage from climate impact?
Minister.
As the lead public body for heritage in Scotland, Historic Environment Scotland published Our Past, Our Future, Scotland's historic environmental strategy. One of this strategy's key priorities is delivering the transition to net zero. It sits along its climate action plan, spanning until the end of 2025, which details how to tackle the causes and mitigate against the impacts of climate change. Climate change doesn't only affect sites in Scotland. However, Historic Environment Scotland is amongst the first to proactively tackle these issues.
Thank you. And Alistair Allen.
Can the Minister give an update on the long-running question of when further work will be progressed by Historic Environment Scotland to ensure that the iconic Kishmalt Castle in Barra can at least partially be reopened to the public?
I understand the member's disappointment that Kishmalt Castle is not open due to the public safety measures. However, the safety of visitors and Historic Environment Scotland staff must continue to be prioritised. Management of the estate is an operational matter for Historic Environment Scotland, and I understand that HES continues to engage regularly with the member, and that the head of the North Region at Historic Environment Scotland is shortly due to meet with Alistair Allen to discuss sustainable options for the reopening of Kishmalt Castle, and I would like to pay tribute to his long-standing and ongoing campaigning in this area.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes questions. Point of order, Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I'd just like to extend my apologies to the Chamber and to you for arriving to the Chamber late and missing my question. It's entirely my fault. I had a diary malfunction. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Ms Hamilton. That is appreciated, obviously regrettable, but I do appreciate that apology to the Chamber. As I say, that concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next portfolio to allow front benches to change. OK, the next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio on this occasion is Justice and Home Affairs. As ever, any member wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the Request to Speak button during the relevant question, and I call question number one, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to assist the Scottish Prison Service in the recruitment of new officers in light of reported concerns regarding an aging prison officer workforce.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, prison officers play a vital role within our justice system, which is reflected in the increase to the Scottish Prison Service resource budget by 10% to £436.5 million this year. This will support the effective operation of our prisons, as well as the recent two-year pay award. This has enabled SPS to advertise better recruitment terms, which I know is continuing to assist with attracting new prison officers. Last year, 581 appointments were made to prison officer roles, with plans in place to recruit up to 780 new officers this year, and SPS current prison officer vacancy rate is less than 1%.
Emma Harper.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Through discussions with prison staff in my South Scotland region and with constituents who have unsuccessfully applied to work for the service, it has become clear that the aptitude testing which is used for pre-interview screening is a recruitment barrier. Prison staff tell me that the best candidates for the position, those with life experience and strong interpersonal skills, with empathy and understanding, are not always able to pass the numerical reasoning and spatial awareness online testing, skills which many feel are not relevant for the job. Given this, can the Cabinet Secretary outline whether this is a matter which has been discussed with the SPS and whether consideration could be given to changing this aptitude testing for SPS recruitment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Scottish Prison Service recruitment practices are aligned to civil service recruitment standards and are underpinned by an assessment of skills, values and behaviours of prospective employees. In 2019, SPS removed minimum qualification requirements for prison officers. However, the aptitude test remains a critical mechanism to assure the Scottish Prison Service that those coming into the organisation have the required literacy, numeracy and reasoning skills to operate effectively as a frontline member of staff in an operational role. Whilst I have not discussed this issue with SPS directly, I know that they regularly review their recruitment practices to ensure compliance with relevant guidance and legislation and to ensure that recruitment is applied fairly and consistently.
Thank you. Supplementary, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. HMP Kilmarnock recently transitioned into public ownership, but the process of harmonising staff contracts into public sector terms and conditions is taking longer than expected. The Prison Officer Association also estimated that the SPS needs to recruit between 50 to 70 new staff for the prison. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us when the harmonisation process will complete, and can she update us today on how many of the additional staff needed have been recruited so far?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, can I assure Ms Dowie that there is no delay to a process that has been agreed and communicated well in advance of the very welcome move of HMP Kilmarnock into public ownership and as part of the Scottish Prison Service. The Scottish Prison Service, and indeed I think I have said on a number of occasions that the harmonisation process will take a year because of the different and indeed better terms and conditions within the Scottish Prison Service, where there are two grades of prison officers, and that is in contrast to the roles and grades within HMP Kilmarnock under its private owner. So this is entirely normal and an entirely acceptable practice, and it is excellent news that staff in HMP Kilmarnock will, in a very short period of time, benefit from better terms and conditions.
Question 2 is not lodged. Question 3, Sandy Scolhani.
To ask the Scottish Government for what reason it has reportedly spent nearly £400,000 of public money to promote Scotland's new hate crime laws.
Mr Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. £390,000 was invested in the Hate Hurts National Campaign Crime Marketing, which ran from the 11th of March to the 31st of March 2024, and it included a broadcast and print campaign. The campaign aimed to raise public awareness of hate crime by showing the impact that this has on those affected, for example, on a disabled person or due to someone's race or religion, and to also encourage those who are witnesses or victims of hate crime to report it. During the development of the hate crime strategy, we heard from people who felt unable to leave their homes due to fear of being targeted by hate crime. And we want to have a society where everyone feels safe. There was no funding spent to promote the Hate Crime Act.
Sandy Scolhani.
Well, we've heard what the Minister has to say, but £60,000 of public money was squandered on the ludicrous Hate Monster campaign, which was patronising, embarrassing and offensive, treating the Scottish public like children. Last Wednesday, during our debate on repealing the Hate Crime Act, Stuart McMillan argued that the new law implements a higher threshold for criminality than the long-standing stirring up of racial hatred offence. Either the SNP's own MSPs don't understand the Act, or they are right, and the Act makes it harder to prosecute actual hate in the form of racism. Which is it, Minister?
Minister.
Thank you. Firstly, if I could say to Mr Galhani, the Hate Monster campaign had nothing to do with the Scottish Government and it was a Police Scotland decision. Now, in relation to the hate crime, we know that there were lots of incidents reported in the last 3 weeks, but as of figures that were released yesterday, there's been 654 hate crime incidents recorded with Police Scotland, 51% are for race.
And supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Hate Crime Act has been the subject of much misrepresentation and inaccurate commentary, some of which appears to have been deliberate, causing confusion about what the Act actually does. Can the Cabinet Secretary say any more about steps which are being taken to ensure that the public have accurate information about the Act available to them?
Yeah. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've noted the misinformation and misrepresentation of the Act, and also that for many commentators on it, they've ignored the people in our communities which this seeks to protect. Following the statement in Parliament last week, the Scottish Government published a new fact sheet on the law, which alongside an existing information note on the Hate Crime Act provides further clarity and factual information on what the Act does and, importantly, what it does not do. We are also undertaking a series of engagements across communities to both listen and raise awareness of hate crime.
Question 4, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority regarding plans to incorporate any precedent set by Miller versus College of Policing case into the recording of non-crime hate incidents.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the UK-wide practice of recording non-crime hate incidents dates back to recommendations in the 1999 Stephen Lawrence Inquiry Report. The College of Policing recently published updated guidance on this matter for England and Wales, and whilst not directly applicable to Police Scotland, they are currently reviewing it. If there are proposed changes, this will be subject to consultation. How hate crime is investigated and recorded is an operational matter for Police Scotland. However, I have discussed the issue with the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority and will do so again, and will be raising this with the Chief Constable when we next meet.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response, and I mean, she's absolutely correct. My concern is regarding Police Scotland and the fact that at the moment we appear to have an unclear process, at least in the eyes of the public, as to what exactly is termed a non-hate crime incident. Now, my concern is that a number of people may have sought a subject access request notice and find themselves egregiously believing that their name has been recorded. And so, therefore, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary has explored that possibility with Police Scotland as part of her deliberations, or whether she intends to do so.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, while I have to be clear that this is indeed an operational matter, my conversations, I would hope, with the SPA and indeed Police Scotland will cover a range of matters, many of which have been raised with me directly in this chamber. I very much agree that clarity on these matters is important, and my understanding is that this work to review the guidance and code published by the College of Policing, that Police Scotland do consider this to be a priority and are progressing with matters, and that their conclusions will come to a conclusion shortly, and thereafter they will consult if there are any changes, particularly with their officers, stakeholders and staff associations, and I will endeavour to keep the member updated.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary indicates in her response to Michelle Thompson that Police Scotland are still applying their pre-existing policy on recording non-crime hate incidents. Can she clarify if that policy is being applied on an even-handed basis, as evidence would suggest that that is no longer the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, let me state unequivocally that I have faith in Police Scotland as an organisation that has human rights to its core, and that they will apply the law, but also their procedures fairly and without fear or favour to any party. If there are issues that Mr Fraser would like to explore further, either with myself, I would be more than happy to do that, notwithstanding that this is indeed an operational matter.
And Pauline McNeill.
There is some confusion around this matter. I'm further confused in terms of the Cabinet Secretary's answer. She says that the police apply the law. Now, is it the law, or is the hate incident reporting a process? Is it the law, or is it a process? If it's a process, does the Cabinet Secretary not share my concern that since England and Wales dropped this last year, and since I already raised this matter, are the government content that it
complies with human rights law to put in someone's record something that's not required by law, unless I am confused. I think we need to get this matter resolved ASAP.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, and as I said in my earlier response to other colleagues, that this matter is being considered as a priority by Police Scotland. It is important to acknowledge that while the original ruling and indeed the information that's come from the College of Policing isn't directly applicable to Scotland, it is imperative that we do look at it, to evaluate that, to consider that. In terms of what the actual ruling said, just in brief, the judge held that the perception-based recording of non-crime incidents is not per se unlawful, but said that some additional safeguards should be put in place, and that is what those with operational responsibility are seeking to address and to ensure that we can have maximum clarity and confidence. But of course, Presiding Officer, the non-hate crime incidents are separate from the hate crime legislation, and Police Scotland have been clear that they are predicated on the vulnerability of the complainer and are primarily used to determine what care and support can be provided to them. They are not recorded against the alleged perpetrator of that NHCI, and they can be recorded on a vulnerable person database, but there is no direct link between the database, and systems used for disclosure checks.
Thank you. I appreciate the complexity in the responses, but it would need to be briefer. Question 5, not lodged. Question 6, Michael Marra.
To ask the Scottish Government, in the light of the reported situation facing former clients of McClure solicitors, what discussions it has had regarding enabling the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission to consider groups of complaints rather than considering complaints purely on an individual basis.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I've said before, my sympathies are with the former clients who have been affected by the collapse of McClure's solicitors. The Scottish Government has discussed with the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission and the Law Society of Scotland if a group proceeding complaint would be feasible, and their view is that it is important individual complaints continue to be investigated on their own merits and that complaints are detailed and submitted by the individuals affected. This does not prevent specific staff familiar to the matter being allocated to consider those complaints.
Michael Marra.
Thank the Minister for that answer. A number of my constituents in the North East were clients of McClure's and were advised by solicitors to put their house into trust. Those constituents are now facing a very expensive and complex legal process to end the trust. And it would appear that clients in particular areas of the country were targeted and sold services that they did not need. And fear of care costs in the future were used to justify a significant legal and financial decision that's now costing my constituents dearly. But enabling the SLCC and the Law Society to investigate groups of complaints could allow for early detection of such patterns of behaviour and the advent of those kind of cases. So what more is the Scottish Government doing to understand the scale of the problem facing former clients of McClure's, the geographical distribution of those clients across the country, and what further changes in legislation can be made to prevent similar situations from happening in the future?
Minister.
Thank you. The Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill introduces authorisation of legal businesses bringing benefits for such a greater consistency in regulating legal firms, enabling the Law Society as a regulator to identify and address deficiencies early. I am bringing forward amendments at Stage 2 intended to deliver further improvements to the legal complaint system, and my officials have been working very closely with the Law Society and the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. I am very happy to meet Mr Marra if he wants to discuss any of these.
And supplementary, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank the Minister for that last comment. Can the Minister speak to any amendments, any further amendments with regards to the Regulation of Legal Services Bill that she is considering with regards to the situation with McClure's? Because, as the Minister knows, it's certainly something that's affected so many of my constituents.
Minister.
Thank you, and I thank Mr McMillan for that question. I know that he's been doing a lot of work on this over previous months. As I said to Mr Marra, I am considering options for amendments ahead of Stage 2, reflecting on the views of stakeholders and also MSPs, with the intention of building consensus around reform. I'll bring forward amendments at Stage 2 intended to deliver further improvements to the legal complaints system, and my
as I said previously, my officials are working very closely with the Law Society and Scottish Legal Complaints Commission on amendments to make significant improvements.
Question 7, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government within what timescale it plans to respond to the Scottish Law Commission's findings and recommendations arising from its consultation on damages for personal injury.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Law Commission has not yet published a report following their damages for personal injury consultation. It is expected in the summer, and I look forward to receiving it. And when I've had the time to consider any findings and recommendations, I will respond and I will ensure that the Parliament is aware of that.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Does the Minister agree with me that the legal time bar to claims for those pursuing compensation because of exposures to asbestos is unjust and needs brought to an end? The Scottish Law Commission are likely to present recommendations on this issue in their forthcoming report with draft legislation. Will the Scottish Government commit to urgent consideration of their work, including possible changes to the law to allow claims to be made? Many are being denied justice at present, and this needs to be remedied as soon as possible.
Minister.
I thank the member for the question. The Law of Limitation serves as an important function to ensuring that legal claims are advanced quickly, and where a claim is made out with the relevant time limit, the court can exercise its discretion to override it and allow a claim to proceed. I'll be interested to hear what the SLC has to say on this important issue, and as I mentioned, I expect it to be published this summer. I will respond to its recommendations once I've had the time to consider them fully, and I will make sure that the member and Parliament is kept aware.
Thank you. Question 8, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taken to support the mental health of frontline police officers in light of reports that reductions in the number of police officers is putting increasing pressure on the service.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we have provided an additional £75.7 million of resource funding for policing, which enables Police Scotland to retain police numbers of around 16,500 to 600. Scotland continues to have more police officers per capita than England and Wales, and higher pay ranges for officers at all ranks. The number of new recruits stands at around 1,680 since 2022. While the mental health of police officers is a matter for the Chief Constable under the oversight of the SPA, I can assure the member that the Scottish Government supports recent initiatives, for example, the development of a wellbeing action plan that will be presented to the SPA this summer.
Mark Griffin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. FY figures have shown that between 2018-19 and 2022-23, the number of working days lost to mental health absences soared by 67% amongst police officers and 165% amongst police staff. Can the Cabinet Secretary give an update on the number of mental health absences among police officers and staff, and what impact this has had on the number of crimes being investigated?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I will certainly request that the SPA provide that information directly to Mr Griffin. What I will say is that the health and wellbeing of police officers and staff, civilian staff, is a matter of the utmost importance. I was very pleased that the Chief Constable has ensured that this is very high on her agenda. Policing is, of course, a relentless job, and it's a job like no other, but wellbeing and workload priority and reducing some of those unreasonable demands on police officers has been taken very seriously indeed, both by Police Scotland, this Government and the SPA, and we will endeavour to work together to take matters forward, particularly in light of the recent HMICS frontline focus report.
Thank you. We've got a number of supplementaries. First, Audrey Nicol.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update regarding the steps being taken to ensure the increased SPA resource budget specifically supports further police recruitment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, following the publication of the Scottish Budget last December, the Chief Constable told Parliament's Criminal Justice Committee that the policing budget settlement for 24-25 would allow Police Scotland to restart officer recruitment for the year ahead and to retain officer numbers at around 16,600. And I was very pleased to see that last month Police Scotland welcomed almost 200 new officers with further intakes planned throughout this year. And in terms of the SPA budget, their budget has increased by 5.6% in revenue, and this was certainly welcomed by the Chief Constable and puts policing in this country on a very strong footing.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you, President. Also, the National Police Wellbeing Service supports officers across the UK with its Blue Light Wellbeing Framework. Police Scotland said they intended to sign up, but now appear to have gone cold. And in his new report, His Majesty's Inspectorate of Policing is urging them to revisit this. So does the Cabinet Secretary support his call?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very much welcomed the independent report from the independent inspector. It is a matter and a report that I have discussed on a number of occasions with him and also the SPA. While all of the recommendations made by the Inspectorate of Constabulary are for Police Scotland and SPA, I can assure him that this government stands ready to support the implementation of those recommendations.
And Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Years of staff time is being lost because officers and supporting teams are struggling under the pressure. In 2022, 65% of officers who left with less than 2 years' service cited personal reasons for leaving. What more can the Scottish Government do to support Police Scotland's new police officers with their mental health and ensure that the investment in their training is backed up with investment in their wellbeing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Ms Wishart raises a very important point because one of the central points of the Frontline Focus report for the Inspector of Constabulary was making the point that while Police Scotland have excellent arrangements in place when there are catastrophes and incidents that are very traumatic for serving police officers, where further action is recommended is around those organisational and day-to-day stressors. So her point is very well made that particularly for new recruits that there needs to be an additional focus and endeavour.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on Justice and Home Affairs. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.